Boy, is it gonna cause WrestleMania.
Hey, folks.
I was gonna introduce this guy. Raise your hand if you don't know who Bob Gibbon is.
Never saw before.
Exits are that way. I'm kidding. Just kidding. Yeah. 1967, October 20th. History was made. Roger Patterson and Bob Gibbon were in that riverbed at Bluff Creek. What you see in that film is exactly what Bob saw. It is amazing footage. I'm going to turn it over to him. Ladies and gentlemen, Bob Gibbon.
Yeah!
Thank y'all. Thank you for being here. Hey, this is a great honor to see you. Folks, I met some of you before, had the pleasure of doing it. Some of those people have come back to say hi again. And let me tell you, it sure makes my day. And to see all of you special people out there, just to come and whatever you're going to ask me a question, or if you want to ask me what the heck I was doing down there, I can tell you, and most of it's true. But anyway, folks, it's your pleasure to be up here and be able to talk to you folks. I'll tell you, it makes old Bob's hat head hard to even fit this hat, you know. I might have to get another size or two bigger, but I'll just put, you know, these old cowboy hats, they're made to stretch a little, either way, see. So if you can't win on a go-around, they get smaller. Then if you win, they get bigger. So they're adjustable, cowboy hats are. And I know you all know what a go-around is. That's when they send you out there and say, are you ready to open the shoot, dude? You nod your head and you weren't really ready, but you got ready in a hurry. Okay, folks, we'll go on. There's 40,000 comedians out of work and I'm trying to cut in on the act. So we'll go on with it, and whatever we want to get to talk about, we'll darn sure do it.
Hey, Bob, tell the story.
What story? Oh, that wasn't a story. That was the truth.
Yes.
You know,
tell the truth.
Hey, I got to tell you the difference between a fairy tale and a cowboy story. You know, a fairy tale starts out, once upon a time, this really happened. Cowboy story starts out, hey, partner. No shit, this is the truth. Sorry about that, folks. But anyway, that's the way you're going. And you want me to talk about how it really started and all that?
Yeah, let's hear it.
Is that okay with everybody?
Yeah.
All right. I didn't know much about Bigfoot or Sasquatch or whatever you want to call them. And I hadn't really got interested in it enough to get going on it, but Roger Patterson and I rodeoed together in the late 50s, and then I quit because I had a family, and I had to go to work on Monday morning, and going to work after rodeoing, if you've ever done that, going to work on Monday morning, it's torture, because if your whole body hurts, I mean, parts that you didn't even know you had, you found out you could hurt. So I quit in 1958, even before the biggest part of you kids were born. But so in 1961, I seen a Plymouth pickup sitting in front of my uncle's service station. I never knew they made a Plymouth pickup. So I was really interested in taking a look at it. Had a little set of wooden racks on them. I was standing there looking at it. And a guy come walking out, said, hey, Bob. And it was Roger Patterson. And he said, what are you doing? I said, well, I'm riding horses and driving truck and farming and got a little bit, you know, this and that, whatever I can make a living at. And he said, I want to show you something. And he come back with a big plaster cast. And he said, Bob, this is a Bigfoot. And I said, you doggone right, it's a Bigfoot. And so he said, there was an excavation going on down there by a multi-millionaire by the name of Tom Slick in Northern California and Six Rivers National Forest. But he said Tom Slick died in one of his own planes when it crashed. So the money quit going, and all the guys that was in that left because there was no more revenue coming in. I don't know if any of you guys know who John Green was, or any of those old-time guys around Nadu, Hamden, and all of the ones that were down there in the 50s on that expedition. Well, Roger had met most of these, plus a gentleman named Dr. Ivan Sanderson that was, he lived in New York, but he was writing books, and he mentioned the Bigfoot, and then they called him Bigfoot. You see, you all know mostly where the name Bigfoot came from, didn't you? Well, if you don't know, there was construction workers down in California making roads. A guy named Jerry Crew was one of the guys. And so when he come to work one Monday morning to get on his cat, he had, of course, V8 or 9, whatever it was at that time. I didn't really ever know. These big tracks were all around as a cat. And so Jerry Crew right away quick dipped these things as a Bigfoot. And that's where they got the Bigfoot name of the Sasquatch or whatever name the native folks call them down that area. So the Bigfoot stayed with them until this very day. And of course up north there's Sasquatch. And so Roger tried to get me interested. Well, I was riding quite a few young horses. To get up into the hills, I had to drive past Roger Patterson's home. So, and Roger had been, had some problems, physical problems that I knew about. I didn't see Roger for quite a few years. And so I thought I'd stop and see, you know, how he was doing, and he'd say, "Hey Bob, let me put my horse in your trailer, in your truck." I didn't have a trailer, I had a truck. "And go up and ride with you, and I've got these little cassette tapes out of the battery-powered cassette players." And he said, "I'd like for you to hear some of these." So he had his cassette player. And around the campfires in the evening, he would play these different testimonials of folks that had some connection with Bigfoot. And so he kept asking me to go with him on time. Well, I have regular jobs. And so I would only say, "Well, Roger, maybe I go with you on weekends, but it really isn't my interest because I'm riding colts for folks." And so to get the miles on the colts, I'd get Roger would go along with me, and along at campfires at night, he'd play these cassette for me, you know. And so I got to thinking, well, there can't be that many people having encounters and other people talking about them, that there isn't something out there. So I was kind of down the middle of the road as a believer, but I'm a kind of a Harry Truman type guy. I wanted to see it to believe it. So I didn't get a chance to go with Roger very many times, but when I did, he always played these. And so pretty soon I got to thinking, you know, there's got to be something there. So on just before Labor Day, it was after Labor Day weekend, Roger came driving in my driveway all excited, and he said, "Bob, we need to go to California down to the Bluff Creek area." And I said, "Well, what for?" He said, "Well, they were building roads back in there, going to start logging." So he said they came back to work after Labor Day weekend on Tuesday, and there was big tracks all around the piece of equipment there, three different sizes of tracks. And they assumed it was a male, female, and a ewe. So I'd never seen the track out. So he said, "Would you take me down there?" Well, I had a horse van truck. I had a one-ton Chevrolet truck, a dual-wheel one-ton Chevrolet truck, and had a nice horse van built up on the back because that was my business, horses and then my regular jobs. So I said, "Well, Roger, I can't just quit my regular job." And then I was hot roofing at the time, folks. And any of you folks that know anything about hot roofing, fall of the year, the guy that's last hired gets first fired. So I knew that my job was going to terminate probably by Thanksgiving. So I started getting things together. It took a while to get people lined up to take care of my animals, and my wife worked, so she didn't want that extra chore of trying to feed horses, cows, and that was about all I had. I didn't have any, you know, other animals, much of horses and cows. Anyway, I finally got it all arranged and got the horses loaded up. And down, Roger told me how to get where I was going. And we went in there. We ended up there at the little town called Willow Creek. And then we started back in the mountains and on some fairly decent roads. They were mostly just gravel roads then. And we went back about, it was over 30 miles or so back in the mountains there, and those mountains are really, they're rugged, nice teeth with wonderful timber on them, beautiful trees. And so we went to a little area that Roger said, this is Onion Mountain. Just go over the side and down to the bottom to Bluff Creek. So that's what I did. I drove across the creek because it was down to about 16 inches in the fall of the year. I'll give you some time frame on that. The time I got down there, I can't remember whether it was actually the last day of September or the first day of October. But by the fall of the year, you know, the creek was only about 16, 18 inches deep and about 25 feet across. So I went ahead, I figured this truck's a two-wheel drive, but it can make it across there. So I did. We got on the other side. And people told me a lot of other times that I cantered a place called Laos Creek, and they kept telling me that. Well, I didn't know the names of anything down there. So, but I'll tell you what, I got down there to where this piece of equipment was, in that softer material, dirt, basically just dirt. And they didn't put any rock or gravel around this piece of equipment because I don't think they had really got to it yet. So I looked there and wanted to see these footprints that they talked about that was the reason we went down there. Well, these footprints were so beat up from humans coming around looking at them, because I guess the word got back in to Willow Creek right away that there was tracks around this piece of equipment. So between humans running around there and it raining pretty hard, I was terribly disappointed in trying to find a decent track to be able to observe. So then we went ahead and went up to Onion Mountain and on down, made camp. And so I was so disappointed, I said, you know, I made this trip, rather expensive, you know, fuel or whatever. And so he said, well, can we stay down here a few days and ride? I said, well, we might as well, because, you know, I ain't going to turn around and go back today. And so we did. And every day we would saddle up every morning early. And if there's any cowboys in here and ever had to go what they call a roundup, that's about the same thing Roger and I did, looking for evidence. We made big circles, and usually about 25 to 30 miles, we'd ride all day, and up and down, and uneven ground, and nice riding, and then some not so good. But anyway, you know how it is riding in the mountain. So this went on, and on, and on, and on. Every day, we went a different direction. Never saw a track. And we ride the lowlands along the creek. Along the creeks where there's a type of soil that would leave a footprint if anything went through there. Well, I saw every kind of print except the Bigfoot print. You know, I saw all kinds, raccoon, deer, bear, and whatever else, you know, was down in that area making a track. But no Bigfoot tracks. So I'll tell you, This was like 20 days of hard riding. And I was used to riding lots of hours anyway, so it didn't bother me that much. But anyway, on the 20th day of October, Roger and I had covered so many miles and making these big circles. But the old cowboys used to do that, and they called it roundup. Now they call it gathering. I don't know what the difference is. Still get the cattle in where they're supposed to go. So I'll tell you what, we decided that we would take a little old pack horse that Roger had there, a little POA, that's Pony of America. It's not very big, only about that tall. Stout little guy used for a pack horse. And we packed what we needed to stay for 2 or 3 days. We decided to ride back about 35, 36 miles further back than we had gone before, because we weren't doing any, wasn't having any luck in the areas that we covered in these big circles to come back at night and camp. So that particular day on October 20th, the sun was shining bright, beautiful day. We left camp just about right after lunch with all the equipment to stay at least 2 or 3 days back, you know. And all that consisted of was a sleeping bag and a little bit of food and what we needed to eat. Thank you. And so we were just riding along, and Roger was riding in front of me most of the way, but the leaves were all turning yellow and red, and colors were absolutely beautiful. Sunshiny day, warm, and we were just happy as we could be that we was going to go back and make camp and then go into some new areas that we hadn't been. So about 3.5-4 miles away from where we were camped, we was riding up along Bluff Creek. And earlier in 63-64, they had a lot of flood in the area down in there. Thank you. That wiped out a lot. I'm gonna have to hurry up. You know, they only allow me so many minutes, and I get started telling you folks about these things, and then I forget about that time frame. But anyway, I'll get busy and tell you this very quickly, okay? Is that all right with everybody? Okay, folks, what we did, rode out that right afternoon, riding up the creek, alongside the creek, and come to this big downfall root system about 8, 9, 10 feet tall, and the creek had rerouted itself around it, I guess, because it was around that. And as Roger and I went around that big downfall, one was standing across the creek from us, and from where we were at, Roger was in front of me on his horse, where we were at and across the creek, and where it was standing fairly close to the creek, was probably about 45, 50 feet. I never measured it because I didn't really think I needed to. So this all, and it happened so fast after that, Roger was getting off his horse the best he could. The horse was jumping up and down, and at one time I said, "Horse, Roger's horse blew up," and some lady jumped up and said, "How many pieces, Bob?" I said, "No, wait. No, it didn't blow up. It kind of acted up." So anyway, this all happened. Roger got his camera out of there and getting off, and he's quite an agile guy because he was a gymnast at one time. And so by Roger being able to get his camera out of the saddlebag, and by that time, this creature, I'm going to call it a creature, I'm not going to call it she yet because I didn't have no idea what it was, a male or a female. So Roger started trying to film it. Well, he ran across the creek. When he got on the other side, he kind of stumbled and fell down on like that on his elbows. So then he jumped up and ran over to a downfall log that was half buried in the sand, stabilized his elbows on that, and started getting good film. So anytime that you folks have seen that footage on TV or any other way that you might have seen it, that's what all became out of that. And that's called the Roger, or the Patterson Gimlin film, and it was made October 20th, 1967. And that's what changed my entire life that day. And for a few years, it was not really happy. But now when I meet folks like you, great folks like all of you, that's my paycheck, folks, for the bad days that I had. Thank you so much. You guys are great. Folks, right quick, like, if you guys don't mind, and you gotta holler at me, stand up, and just yell at me, because Russ, there's a lady right there that wants to know.
Have you seen another Bigfoot since then? Have you traveled to other locations where other Bigfoot
yes,
sightings?
Yes, I don't mean to cut you off, but yes, I have, and I have kind of seen and. This kind of cannot is kind of a, you know, a gray area, but I've been close to them that's let out screams and hollers, and in the dark, in nighttime, I'm not being able to see them, and fairly close to me. And then I had one more experience that I was in my tent coming up from the Mexican border. I rode all summer in the summer of 78, and up in northern Oregon, was camped underneath a big old pine tree, and something kicked me or bumped my ribs. I look up, and it was one of those nights where the moon was there, but the clouds were coming over. Some giant thing was standing above me while I was way out of any town. And all I had was the pack mule and the horse out in the meadow about 600 yards away. And so by the time I got my boots on, and got outside, the clouds came over the moon, or came in between me and the moon, so it was dark again. So I couldn't see really where it went, but it was gone.
Hey, a real cowboy would have kept his boots on when he slept. Anyway, here's what I
said. Yeah, but not a real cowboy, I just found this man.
When you and Roger Patterson saw this thing afterwards, did you manage to make any, you know, visible tracks or further tracks that you could record? And did it make any kind of sound?
Sir, I'll answer part of that first. It never made a sound as far as I heard. It left lots of tracks, and we got casts of those. And we still got copies of the original cast. I've got one on the table down there. If you want to stop by the table and take a look at it, it was one of the copies of a copy of the tracks, but it's good. Until 2003, because of my job and other things, my family, my job, but it was so much different. In all area that didn't have any trees was tall trees, 25, 30 feet, in the same area where it had walked. And so the whole area changed so dramatically. It was hard for me to recognize it the first time I went down. The last couple of two or three times I've been down there, then I finally walked enough to recognize some of the hills that I'd ridden over and some of the big rocks that I'd passed. But the whole creek had rerouted itself about 100 feet from where it was originally at the time that Roger and I got the film.
Okay, Bob, we have one more question from this gentleman right here.
Here's
the thing. I want to announce before we get out of here, on the other side of this hallway, Bob has a table if you haven't invited us in yet. I will say that we're putting together a film of this exact incident right here that we're talking about. It's illustrated, and it's taking a lot of work and a lot of time. But before we can pitch this into the networks, you'll see we'll hand out a business card. It has to show that people are interested in it before Netflix or and we'll plan it, we'll take it. So stop by, check his hand, we'll make it hard. If you guys can help us advertise that or show an interest in it, that would be great. Last question.
Has Bigfoot not been scientifically proven, I guess, because there hasn't been enough sightings of him? Or why is he not scientifically real?
Well, you know, Dr. Grover Krantz mentioned that one time, and I'll very well start on that. He said, Bob, we got to have a body to prove it. Well, I disagree. There has been so many people over the years, and probably some of you sitting right out there, have been very, very close to the Sasquatch Bigfoot and seen how things go, and have refused to talk too much about it, because sometimes they can put a different name on you. Maybe you're a little different, or you're a little short of a whole brick load, you see. So nobody wants to talk about it, even if it, and some people, if I'm honest with you, if you come and sit down at breakfast with them, they'd say, no, they don't exist. So, you know, we just excuse those people because they're not really understanding what might be. Because every day there seems to be something new come up that us as human beings at this time don't really think exists. You see, so there's so many things out there to talk about until we learn more about them and get a little more idea that they're not out there to be shot at or hunted down or anything like that, or being feared so much of, unless they have a reason to be feared. And so that's about all I can tell you about that, sir, is that there has been so much evidence out there, and I'll bet if you had a chance to talk to every individual in this room, you'd get to hear some really, really interesting stories. Thank you all. You guys have been wonderful. Thank you.